Hi guys, welcome back to the channel. In the last three tutorials, we covered the shadow mapping technique using the basic light types, spot, directional, and point light. We also witnessed some of the common problems with shadow mapping, so today I'd like to go over several techniques that can mitigate these problems to some extent. Okay, so the first problem is shadow acne, which is also known as erroneous self-shadowing. This is basically a shadow interleaved with non-shadowed pixels. The reason for this problem is that the interpolation of the triangle in the shadow pass is different from the interpolation in the lighting pass because these are usually two different viewpoints. This means that there can be minor numerical differences between the depth of the pixel in the two passes. This can cause some pixels to win the shadow test while neighboring pixels would fail. Another problem is that during the lighting pass, we may have two neighboring pixels that are actually covered by the same texel in the shadow map. In that case, one pixel may get the same depth as in the shadow map or slightly lower, while the other one ends up behind the shadow map, so to speak. In the following example, the only object being rendered is the flat terrain. When the light points directly down, there is no problem. All the pixels have the same depth in the shadow map, and during the lighting pass we calculate this depth again, so all pixels are lit. However, as the light hits the surface at sharper angles, the shadow acne artifact appears. Now, I did mention this problem in a previous tutorial, and the solution there was to add a small bias to the depth from the shadow map. This bias kind of pushes the shadow map away, allowing the problematic pixels to win the shadow test. However, on some cases when there is no bias, we can see the problem on the terrain and the roof of the house, but the shadow of the house itself and the chimney actually looks good. If we add the bias, the problem on the terrain is gone, but we have a new problem with the house and the chimney. The bias causes the shadow to drift away, a problem known as Peter Panning. Isn't that a great name? I absolutely love it. The solution to this problem is to make the bias dependent on the angle between the light and the pixel normal. When the two vectors are aligned, we want the bias to be zero, and as the angle between them grows, we want the bias to increase in order to fight shadow acne. So to do that, we provide the light direction and the interpolated normal to the function that calculates the shadow factor. We do a dot product between them. This is basically the same diffuse factor that you should be familiar with. We use the GLSL function mix to do linear interpolation between zero and the maximum bias value that we want to allow. This function takes the range in the first couple of parameters and the interpolation factor in the last parameter. It multiplies the first parameter by 1 minus the factor and adds the second parameter multiplied by the factor. So for example, when the factor is a half, we simply get the average of the two numbers. In our case, we place the maximum value in the first parameter and 0 in the second parameter. When the light vector and the normal are aligned, the dot product is 1, so we get 0. As the angle grows, the diffuse factor decreases towards zero, which brings us closer to the maximum value in the first parameter. As you can see, this solves most of the Peter Panning problem, but we are still seeing some shadow acne on the terrain, and this brings us to the next solution, which is to reverse face culling during the shadow pass. You see, this problem is specific to the pixels that are closest to the light source. When there is no question about the shadow, for example the shadow of the house here, we don't see any problem because the difference in depth between the closest pixel and the one in the shadow is large enough. In this case, it actually doesn't matter whether we compare the depth of the pixel in the shadow of the house with the one on the roof or the one on the wall, which is also on the same light vector. The advantage of using the depth of the pixel on the wall for the shadow test instead of the one on the roof is that in this way the pixel on the roof can easily win the shadow test, even without the help of any bias. To make this happen, we just need to change the shadow pass from the standard back face culling to front face culling. This means the triangles that are facing directly towards the light are dropped and the depth which goes into the shadow map belongs to the back face triangles, the one that you normally don't want to see in standard rendering. Remember that we need to restore back face culling on the entrance to the lighting pass. This solution provides great looking shadow without any acne or Peter Panning. Well, at least in this case. Another interesting option which you may want to consider is to use a hardware feature called slope scale depth bias. The idea is that the GPU automatically adds a small bias to the depth which is written into the shadow map. This bias depends on the orientation of the triangle towards the light source. When the triangle is directly facing the light, we want a minimal bias, and as the slope of the triangle towards the light vector increases, we want the bias to also increase. It's very easy to add slope scale depth bias to the program, though it may require some tweaking, but we are already used to it. Basically, we just need to add a couple of GL function calls. First, we need to enable GL polygon offset fill. Polygon offset is actually the name of this feature in OpenGL. Slope scale depth bias is how it's called in DirectX. Next, we need to call GL polygon offset with two parameters. The first one is the factor, and the second is the units. The bias is calculated by multiplying the slope of the triangle, denoted m here, by the factor and adding an implementation-specific value called r, which is multiplied by the units. Without getting into too much details, the slope is based on the change of z across the triangle face, divided by the change in both x and y. So you can imagine that when the triangle is perpendicular to the light vector, there's no change in z, and as one vertex is tilted away, the change in z increases, while the change in the x and y may even decrease. As I said, r is actually implementation dependent, which means that this feature may behave differently on different GPUs. The point is that if we have two vertices with the same x and y, and the difference between their z values is r, it means that their depth in the shadow map will be different. R simply needs to be the smallest value that guarantees this difference. Again, we don't need to worry about it, because it will be calculated by the GPU. I have to admit that I'm not very familiar with this feature, so I encourage you to play with it and see for yourself. The next problem that I want to talk about happens when the orthogonal projection frustum of the light is not large enough, so during the lighting pass we may render pixels that are visible from the camera point of view, but they are actually outside the view frustum of the light source. This means that the UV coordinates that we calculate in order to sample from the shadow map end up above 1 or below 0. This case is handled by OpenGL according to the configured wrapping mode of the texture. We've been using GL repeat by default with our standard textures, and this is the same with the texture of the shadow map. The problem is that GL repeat causes the same texture to reapply over and over. For example, if one of the texture coordinates is 1.1, it will be handled as if it is 0.1. In the case of the shadow map, this means that when we go outside of the texture, we compare the depth of two non-matching pixels. The result is that we can see the shadow repeated in the area which is outside of the light view frustum. The solution here is simply to change the wrapping mode from GL repeat to GL clamp to border, and to set the border color to all ones. When the texture coordinates overflow the range 0 to 1, we clamp them to the border of the texture, and we return the border color which is set to 1. So all the pixels that overflow the texture win the shadow test, and the incorrect shadow is gone. As you can see, configuring the size of the light view frustum is quite a challenge. If the frustum is too big, the result will be low resolution in the shadow map because we are squeezing in a lot of geometry. This means that each texel in the shadow map covers more pixels in the lighting pass, and we all know what this does. The opposite of this case is when the frustum is too small, and then we simply leave some of the objects outside of the shadow map, so naturally, these objects will not cast any shadow. One solution to this problem is to calculate a tight orthographic projection matrix based on the view frustum of the camera. This projection volume is recalculated whenever either the camera or the light moves, and this guarantees that everything that the camera sees is also rendered into the shadow map. This calculation is pretty straightforward, but it does involve several steps. In step number 1, we calculate the 8 corners of the camera view frustum in view space. This is very simple. We know that in view space, the camera is located at the origin and its target vector is the z-axis. The 4 corners of the near clipping plane are of course located at the distance of z near on the z-axis, and the ones on the far clipping plane are at a distance of z far. We just need to calculate the x and y for each of the points. Let's take y on the near clipping plane for example. The tangent of half the field of view angle is calculated by dividing y by z near. This means that y equals to z near multiplied by the tangent of half the field of view angle. This is our top y. Since the frustum is symmetrical across all axes, the bottom y is simply minus y. We calculate the x in the same manner, and we repeat this process with the four corners of the far clipping plane. The next step is to transform the view frustum back into world space. This simply means multiplying each frustum corner by the inverse of the view matrix. The view matrix transforms from world to view space, so its inverse transforms from view back to world space. Theoretically, you can also calculate the frustum directly in world space, but I find this method to be much easier. Step number 3 is to transform the view frustum from world to light space. Okay, we started at view space because it's very easy to calculate the corners there. We went back to world because this is the actual coordinates that we need, and we switched to light space because it's very simple to calculate the bounding box there. At this stage, we'll assume that the light source is located at the origin, so the world to light transformation simply aligns the light direction with the z-axis. Next, we calculate an axis-aligned bounding box for the frustum. This means getting the maximum and minimum of the XYZ axis by going over all the frustum corners. Now, in order for the tight projection volume to work correctly, it must travel along with the camera. This means that we need to calculate a position for the light source, even though it is a directional light. We do this by finding the center point on the near Z plane of the bounding box. But remember, we are still in light space, so the next step is to transform this light space position back to world space. We can now create a second world to light transformation matrix using both the light position and direction. We use this matrix to transform the view frustum from world to light space for the second time. Remember that the first time we did this transformation, we assumed that the light was at the origin, but now we know exactly where it is, so this will do translation and rotation instead of just rotation. We can now calculate a final axis-aligned bounding box in light space, which we can use to create the orthogonal projection matrix. If everything was done correctly, the near Z of this bounding box will be zero, and the box itself will be symmetrical on both the X and Y. Now, you need to be aware that this solution is not perfect because there may be an object which is outside the view frustum, but it still casts a shadow inside, and this method will miss it. This is discussed in an article by Microsoft, and the suggested solution is to create the left, right, top and bottom planes of the bounding box based on the view frustum, and then create the near and far clipping plane by intersecting this box with the actual scene. However, this is more complex to implement, so today I'm showing you a simpler, albeit less perfect method. If we go to the code, you can see that the entire process is encapsulated in a function called calc tight light projection. This function takes the view transformation matrix from the camera, the direction of the light, and the perspective projection information. It returns the light position in the world and the orthographic projection info. This allows us to create the view and projection matrices for the light. This function pretty much repeats the mathematical process that I described. To make it simpler, I created a couple of classes, frustum and AABB, which is short for axis-aligned bounding box. The frustum class has 8 vectors for the 8 corners of the view frustum. It also has 3 main functions. Calc corners takes the perspective projection info and uses the trigonometry equations that we saw in order to calculate the position of the corners in view space. Next, we have the transform function, which takes a 4x4 transformation matrix and simply transforms each corner one by one. And finally, we have calc AABB, which we will see in a minute. If we go back to calc tight light projection, we can see that the first step is to call calc corners using the perspective projection info that we got from the caller. The frustum is now in view space. Next, we inverse the view matrix, which is also an input parameter. We call the transform function in order to move the frustum from view back to world space. In step number 3, we create the first world to light transformation matrix by placing the light at the origin and using the direction vector that we got from the caller as the target vector. We use the function initCameraTransform, which we normally use for the camera because the world to light and world to view are basically the same thing, just the light instead of the camera. Now that we are in light space, we create an object of the AABB class and we call calc AABB on the frustum object in order to create the bounding box. This function simply adds all the corners into the bounding box, and the AABB class uses each vector to find the minimum and maximum of all of the axes. Next, we calculate two opposing corners on the near Z face of the bounding box. We have the bottom left on the min X and min Y, and the top right on the max X and max Y. Both are on min Z, of course. The position of the light source is calculated by taking the average of these two corners. We also extend this to a 4D vector because we're going to transform it back to world space, which is what we do in the next step using the inverse of the world to light matrix. This gives us the final world space position of the light source, so we also update the parameter that we got as a reference from the caller. We're almost done, so just hang in there for a couple of more minutes. We create a second world to light transformation matrix. This time we use the light position that we've just calculated instead of the origin. We transform the frustum for the second time, and notice that I'm actually using a backup of the frustum in world space, because the original frustum object is still in the old light space. After this transformation, we create the final axis aligned bounding box. The very last step is to call update ortho info, which uses these minimum and maximum values to update the orthographic projection info. Max X is the right side, min X is on the left, min Y is the bottom, and etc. As you can see, this method seems to work well, except when you get very close to the object. In that case, you may want to have some minimum size for the final frustum. Another option is, of course, to try out the Microsoft method. A good resource on all of these problems is an article on shadow mapping by Joy DeVries at learnopengl.com, as well as an article by Microsoft titled Common Techniques to Improve Shadow Depth Maps. Both resources are linked below. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.